Blackstone Audio presents My Dyslexia by Philip Schultz. For my son Eli and his magical hybrid nature. Suffering is the substance of life and the root of personality, for it is only suffering that makes us persons. Miguel de Unamuno. Chapter 1. The idea for this book came out of a commencement address I gave at the Churchill School in Manhattan, a high school for the learning disabled, in the spring of 2009. I was given this honor not because I had won the Pulitzer Prize in Poetry the previous spring for my book Failure, but because I had won it despite the fact that, like so many of the Churchill School's students, I am dyslexic. In several interviews, I spoke openly about my difficulties in learning to read and the problems it has continued to pose. I mentioned the fact that I didn't discover I had dyslexia until I was 58 years old, when my oldest son was diagnosed with it in the second grade. I learned from his neuropsychologist's report that we shared many of the same symptoms, like delayed processing problems, terrible handwriting, misnaming items, low frustration tolerance for reading and most homework assignments involving writing, to name a few. Before long, I was being asked about my dyslexia in every interview, the first question often being, how did someone who didn't learn to read until he was 11 years old and in the fifth grade, who was held back in third grade and asked to leave his school, come to be a professional poet? It's a good enough question, but perhaps an even better one is why I even mention my dyslexia in these interviews. Most of the poems in my book, Failure, concern my father's many business failures and their effect on my mother and me. There's nothing in the book that touches on my dyslexia or my failures as a student. So why had I been so willing, if not eager, to discuss something with strangers that I hadn't discussed at length with my wife or close friends? Even after I found out that I was dyslexic, it was my son's problems that concerned me. Why did such a bright, sweet-natured boy hate school? How it affected my present life wasn't something I even thought about. But suddenly, it seemed to be the only thing I wanted to think about, as if it were a mystery I'd been grappling with my entire life. It has turned out to be just that, a mystery that had been waiting a long time for me to pay attention to it. And having found its moment, it wasn't letting go. But it wasn't a subject I wanted to spend a lot of time thinking about, not when there were so many other more pleasant things to consider. My career, for one thing. It hadn't exactly been thriving before now, and suddenly there was an interest in me and my work. Why would I want to revisit all that angst concerning my inability to read, and now, of all times? I decided to stop mentioning it during interviews, even when asked. But it was too late. I was being called by dyslexia organizations. My friends were asking questions, and even my son wanted to know more about my dyslexia. Suddenly, everyone I knew, it seemed, had either suffered from some kind of learning disability or knew someone who did. And I mean everyone. The parents of my younger son's friends told me about their and their children's issues with it in the school parking lot. People waiting for me to sign their copy of my book after one of my readings would talk at length about their own ordeals with learning to read and the long-term effects of delayed processing and their various struggles with language skills, while others waited impatiently behind them. Suddenly, everyone wanted to talk to me, it seemed, and not about my poetry. It was my dyslexia they were most interested in. The first night after hearing the good news, I finally gave up trying to sleep and came downstairs to find my wife, Monica, sitting at the dining room table, looking equally overwhelmed and bewildered. I was 63 years old and had enjoyed a fair share of luck with grants, awards, and publications, though never before had anything on this scale happened to me. When she asked me what I thought this would mean to our lives, I was unable to formulate enough clear thought to articulate even the most basic hint of what I was feeling. We live on what our school, the writer's studio, provides. We live simply. My wife is a gifted sculptor, and no one becomes a sculptor or poet because they're terribly concerned about money. We own a modest, though comfortable house in East Hampton, which was purchased during a previous recession and added onto as our family grew. In other words, we live the not uncommon lives of working artists who are lucky enough to maintain a lifestyle sufficient to our needs. I should add that I've always thought of myself as blessed. I love what I do, writing poetry, and I equally love the opportunity of teaching the accomplished, hard-working, and deserving people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.